Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower, and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
Today, you will hear reports from Dan Friedel, Anna Mateo, and Jill Robbins. Later, Brian Lynn presents this week's technology report. Finally, we continue our U.S. National Parks journey by heading east to Acadia National Park. But first, this report from Dan and Anna.
Many Ukrainians fled their country in February 2022 when Russia invaded Ukraine. They thought they would be away for a short time. However, as the war continues, many are thinking about setting up homes in their new countries. If the people who left never come back, Ukraine will have to recover from the war with a much smaller population. The country will have to clean up and rebuild. It will also have economic problems without as many workers and business owners. The United Nations Refugee Agency, UNHCR, said its research shows most Ukrainians who left last year want to return home. However, some are starting businesses or finding good work in new countries. They may only return for visits. Natalka Korzh is one of the refugees. She lives in Portugal now. She left a newly built home when Russia invaded her country. In Ukraine, she worked directing television programs. Now, in Portugal, she wants to start a charity organization that will help other refugees. She told the Reuters news agency she is not sure if she will go home when the war ends. Volodymyr Kostyuk is the chief of Pharmak, a Ukrainian company that makes drugs. He once had 3,000 employees, and the company earned $200 million each year. He said he faces a worker shortage. He is worried about the company's success if people do not return home. We need to somehow try to return them to Ukraine because we already see that the longer people are abroad, the less they want to return, said Kostyuk.
A Ukrainian research organization asked 500 businesses about their top concerns for a post-war economy. About one-third said they saw worker shortages as the top problem. Many men are still in Ukraine because they were required to serve in the military, but women and children left as refugees. Another Ukrainian research group, the Center for Economic Strategy, said more than half of the women who left had some higher education. While businesses are worried about workers, they are also concerned about having fewer people who can buy their products. Fazi Group runs food stores in Ukraine. Some of their stores around Kyiv have opened after closing in the first part of the war. However, not as many people buy products as before. Dmytro Sohankov is in charge of new products for Fazi. He said Ukraine's stores cannot recover from the war when so many people are away. We have several million people who simply do not buy anything, he said. They are not in the country. More shoppers came in May compared to last year. But there were 16% fewer shoppers compared to the same month in 2021. Another problem is Ukraine's fertility rate. The fertility rate is the average number of children that a female would have in her life. Most of the people who remain in the country are old. Ella Libanova works for the National Academy of Science of Ukraine. She said the fertility rate has dropped from 0.9 to 0.7. The U.S. estimates as many as 15,000 working-age men have been killed or wounded in the war. In addition, Libanova said, once the war ends, it is not clear that the men will stay in Ukraine. Many will leave to join their families in other countries. She said there is a risk. We will lose young, qualified, enterprising, educated people. That is the problem.
She also said Ukraine's population was already shrinking before the war. But if you consider the land seized by Russia during the war, Ukraine's population may only be 28 million, compared to 41 million at the start of 2022. A study by the European Commission said the country's population could be 20 to 30% lower over the next 30 years. In February, the Center for Economic Strategy asked 1,000 Ukrainian refugees about their plans for the end of the war. The group expects between 860,000 and 2.7 million might stay away for good. The group said Ukraine's economy could shrink by 2.5 to 7.7% each year. I'm Dan Friedel.
And I'm Anna Mateo.
Ernest Hemingway, the Nobel Prize-winning American writer, first visited the Spanish city of Pamplona 100 years ago in July. In July, people celebrate the Feast of Saint Fermín in Pamplona, where the traditional running of the bulls takes place. The event started more than 700 years ago. For 9 days, people come to the northern Spanish city for bull running, bullfighting, and partying. In July, people celebrate the Feast of Saint Fermín in Pamplona, where the traditional running of the bulls takes place. The event started more than 700 years ago. For 9 days, people come to the northern Spanish city for bull running, bullfighting, and partying. The festival affected Hemingway so deeply that he returned 8 times between 1924 and 1959. Here is a description of what happens at the start of the bull running. The bells would toll 8 times. A rocket would be lit, and the bulls would charge out of the gate. At that moment, a crowd of runners wearing white clothes and red scarves would start to run. They would look back, move, and dance to avoid being gored by the charging bull's horns. Onlookers would cheer them on from balconies above. In 1926, Hemingway wrote his first book, The Sun Also Rises. He wrote about his experiences in Pamplona and established himself as the voice of what became known as the Lost Generation, a generation of people affected deeply by the events of World War I. I can't stand it to think my life is going so fast, and I'm not really living it, says one character in the book. Nobody ever lives their life all the way up except bullfighters, is the answer. Bill Hillman is a 41-year-old English professor from Chicago. He first read The Sun Also Rises while he was in college at the age of 20. When he turned to the last page, he said he knew two things. He wanted to become a writer, and he would run in front of Pamplona's bulls someday. Hillman's first running of the bulls was in 2005. He has been running ever since. I got here, and I was just blown away by it. It was everything in the book, but times 10. It was bigger. It was wilder. It was crazier, he told Reuters. He has been gored twice, in 2014 and 2017. But that has not lessened his interest. I've basically been kind of following Hemingway's ghost around. I'm a little bit haunted by him, Hillman added. 69-year-old Cheryl Mountcastle first read The Sun Also Rises at her New Orleans high school in Louisiana. For the past 24 years, she has rented the same apartment in Pamplona for the festival with her family. She said the book does not give details about another side of the festival, such as sharing food and dancing in the street. Leoncy Arrieta is one of the few remaining Pamplona natives who met Hemingway. The 91-year-old tells Reuters that Hemingway and his fourth wife, Mary Welsh, stayed at her house. It was on their last visit to the festival in 1959, 2 years before Hemingway's death. Arrieta remembers that Hemingway wrote, drank vodka, and shocked the family by removing the crucifixes from the wall and putting them away. Last year, 1.7 million people came to the festival, also known as San Fermines. They left 1,200 tons of broken glass and other waste behind. A place on a balcony with a good view of the bull running event can cost $220 per person. Pamplona native Miguel Izu has written about the festival's links to Hemingway. He believes the writer's influence on its popularity has not been as large as people say. Before Hemingway, tourists were already coming, especially from France, Izu explained. However, Izu acknowledges that Pamplona is still using Hemingway to gain attention. We made him into a sort of San Fermines icon, he said. I'm Jill Robbins.
A nonprofit group that studies the history of video games estimates that about 87% of classic games have been lost over time. The estimate was recently published in a study by the Video Game History Foundation. The foundation aims to preserve, celebrate, and teach the history of video games. It also leads public events to raise awareness about historical classic games. The study suggests most classic video games are currently completely unavailable to people who want to buy them. This makes such games critically endangered, the organization said. Other areas of pop culture, such as films, books, and music, faced similar problems. But it is still easy to find those products in stores or on the internet. For example, there are many online video services that show classic movies. And major music services like Apple Music, Google Play, Pandora, and Spotify offer huge collections of old music favorites. It is much harder, however, to find places that sell classic video games. For the study, the Video Game History Foundation examined the availability of all video games released before 2010. That is around the time game makers began to sell their products digitally. Earlier than 2010, game makers usually sold physical copies of games. The nonprofit group says it used a list of 1,500 video games provided by the online information website Mobi Games. The research showed that just 13% of those games are currently available to buy in the marketplace. The foundation noted that the only classic games currently widely available are ones that have been re-released. This means fans of popular classic video games like Super Mario Bros., Pac-Man, and Donkey Kong, which were popular in the 1980s, can still be purchased, but hundreds of others cannot. Researchers involved in the study identified the ways fans can currently get classic games. These include searching for and buying collectible games and old hardware called consoles. People can also travel to libraries that might lend classic games. In addition, some classic games can be downloaded online, but this method might violate copyright laws. In a statement, the Video Game History Foundation states that anyone should be able to easily explore, research, and play classic video games in the same way they can enjoy classic books, music, and movies. Frank Cifaldi is the co-director of the foundation. He tweeted, 9 out of 10 classic video games are no longer available, and that number is unlikely to get any better. It's practically guaranteed that something you grew up with is gone forever. The foundation is calling for organized efforts to preserve classic video game products. This includes a campaign to get libraries and historical organizations to expand their work to save video games, just as they have for old books, movies, and music. Phil Salvador is the library director for the Video Game History Foundation. He said in a statement that since 2012, libraries, museums, and historical organizations have sought new exemptions from the U.S. Copyright Office. These would ease current copyright restrictions for classic games and permit new preservation efforts. So far, the foundation said those efforts have been blocked by groups representing the video game industry. Industry officials have said companies have already established an active, growing market for classic video games. They point to the current availability of some popular classic games. Game makers argue that libraries might try to interfere with their own efforts if current copyright rules were changed. Such preservation efforts might hurt their businesses. The foundation admits there are currently more classic video games being released than ever before, but it says stronger preservation efforts are needed to protect more games. Kelsey Lewin is co-director of the Video Game History Foundation. He said the main goal of the study was to call attention to how dire the state of game availability is. He said his group hopes to effect changes to our copyright laws that will make video game preservation stronger and able to take on the challenges of the future. I'm Brian Lynn.
Brian Lynn joins me now to talk more about this week's technology report. Thanks for being here, Brian.
Sure, Ashley. Glad to be here.
Your report described a study that found about 87% of classic video games are no longer available in the marketplace. What did you learn about who is searching for these games?
So yes, this is an interesting question for sure. One major group that wants to find them is video game researchers, especially those with an interest in video game history. Some of these researchers, for example, have tried to get copies of games and information from game makers, but the game developers are resistant to cooperate with the researchers, mostly because such efforts take time and resources, but do not bring in money.
And the report notes that major gaming companies have so far not been willing to support changes to copyright laws that would make it easier to preserve classic games. Why is this?
It seems the main reason is similar to why they would not want to help individual researchers. Cooperation would require the companies to work with other parties on preservation efforts, and gaming companies generally do not see such efforts as necessary or helping their businesses. Right now, it really comes down to a question of demand, and there's simply not a great enough demand to bring back hundreds of classic games for what seems to be a very small number of people.
Well, thanks again for being here, Brian, and thank you for that report.
You're welcome. Thank you, Ashley.
On our national parks journey, we are exploring the oldest national park east of the Mississippi River. Much of the park sits on a rocky island off the coast of Maine, called Mount Desert Island. Here, you will find the tallest mountain on the east coast. You will also find black bears, moose, and more than 300 kinds of birds. This national park also holds unique Native American and European history. It is called Acadia. The 14,000-hectare park is one of the smaller major national parks in the country. Yet, Acadia sees almost 3 million visitors every year. They come to experience stunning views and take part in outdoor activities like hiking and biking and swimming in the crisp blue Atlantic Ocean.
Acadia National Park has had many names throughout history. It was first declared a national monument in 1916. Its name, Sierre des Monts National Monument, was changed by Congress in 1919. It then became known as Lafayette National Park. In 1929, the park became Acadia National Park, from a past name for the area. The name Acadia probably comes from Arcadia, an area of Greece. It is said that an Italian explorer working for the King of France sailed by the area in 1524. The explorer thought that the landscape looked like the Greek area of Arcadia.
Mount Desert Island also got its name from early European explorers. Frenchman Samuel Champlain arrived on the island in 1604. He described the island's tall peaks as bare and rocky. He named the island, in French, Île des Monts Déserts, or Island of Desert Mountains. Today, locals still say the word desert, similar to its French pronunciation, désert. Champlain and his team were not, of course, the first humans on the island. Native Americans were the first to inhabit the area. Shells and other archaeological evidence on the island date back more than 5,000 years. The native Wabanaki people arrived there in boats made from the wood of birch trees. They hunted, fished, collected berries, and harvested clams from the sea. Wabanaki people called the island Pemetic, or sloping land.
This sloping land is home to Cadillac Mountain. It is the highest point along America's eastern coast at 466 meters. The island owes its landscape to ancient glaciers that once covered the area. Cadillac Mountain is known as the first point in the U.S. that is touched by the rising sun each morning. The name of its early inhabitants, the Wabanaki, translates to People of the Dawn. Today, the summit of Cadillac Mountain is often packed with visitors, many of whom arrive in cars and buses. It is one of the major tourist attractions within the park.
Many tourists also visit what may be the most photographed rock in the state. Bubble Rock is a giant boulder. It sits right on the edge of the summit of South Bubble Mountain. It was moved here by powerful ancient glaciers. Bubble Rock looks as though the slightest wind may push it over the mountain's edge. Visitors often take photos of themselves trying to push the huge rock off the mountain. Of course, Bubble Rock does not move. The Bubble Rock Trail winds up South Bubble Mountain. It is one of the most popular hiking trails in the park. But Acadia does offer solitude for visitors hoping to enjoy the quiet of nature. Within the park are more than 200 kilometers of trails. Many lead to stunning views of the rocky main coast. Some take you to pebbled beaches or quiet lakes surrounded by forest.
Many visitors to Acadia spend most of their time exploring Mount Desert Island. But the Skudik Peninsula is equally beautiful. The National Park Service now protects more than 1,300 hectares of land there. Skudik offers secluded beaches and peaceful hiking trails.
In summer months, visitors can take a boat from the town of Bar Harbor on Mount Desert Island to the town of Winter Harbor on Skudik Peninsula. The tiny fishing town is a great place to enjoy Maine lobster in many forms. A few small family-owned restaurants serve classic Maine dishes like lobster soup, lobster rolls, or simple steamed lobster. But wherever visitors explore in Acadia, they will leave wishing they could see more. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Katie Weaver.
That's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak.